really good feeling to come out, you know.
This is either a Led Zeppelin video or a James Bond film.
I think so.
Rob and I were born as brothers. Gretzel came along as a little angel, and Weiland just appeared.
I think you have to have an ego to some extent to be able to get up in front of 20,000 people every night and fool yourself that you're going to entertain them.
Stone Temple Pilots in 1990, its members experienced almost immediate full-fledged rock stardom. That included a lot of media attention, much of it harsh. From the beginning, Stone Temple Pilots were thrashed by rock critics for everything from hair color to personal excess to a certain likeness to a certain other band.
And in music, Stone Temple Pilots were on tour. They were great the first time I saw them, when they were called Pearl Jam.
Despite media bashing, STP sold over 8 million records with their first two releases. The contrast between what the press deemed cool and what people wanted to hear was illustrated by the 1994 Rolling Stone Readers Poll. Critics voted Stone Temple Pilots the worst band of the year, while readers gave them best new band honors.
Of course it bummed us out, but I think we just eventually just took an attitude like it. You know, we're just gonna make music and do what we do.
After spending his formative years just outside of Cleveland, Weiland ditched small town life for the thriving punk scene of Southern California. Meanwhile, in Point Pleasant, New Jersey, the DeLeo brothers were bored with the music scene there and each made a separate journey to the West Coast.
Weiland and I met at a concert in Long Beach, California, and found out actually we were kind of seeing the same girl. There was a band playing one night. Derek was the loudest out of the band. We just heard drums and we said, we gotta have that guy. And we just couldn't find a guitar player to complete the project. And I always had my bro on my mind.
Well, the way I tell it, they were dead till I got there, you know.
Ironically enough, even though I grew up on the West Coast and these guys grew up on the East Coast, we all pretty much had the same musical background.
And Weiland, he got really into like a whole other realm of music that, you know, I didn't really experience much with. Yeah. And the mixture is as you hear.
Mighty Joe Young, as they first called themselves, spent most of their time hustling gigs around their home base of San Diego before venturing up north to play LA's rock landmark, The Whiskey. They were quickly noticed and signed to Atlantic Records on April Fool's Day, 1992.
I went back to my job and I told them I was leaving, that I just signed a record deal, and they did not take me seriously. They're like, okay, yeah, right, April Fool's, go back to work. I'm like, no, really, man, I'm out of here.
You ready there, Fellini?
Let's go.
I am smelling like the roses somebody gave me, 'cause I'm dead.
Only a few weeks before the release of its major label debut, Mighty Joe Young, the band, were informed that a blues singer in Chicago named Mighty Joe Young owned the rights to the name.
It was just the worst. It was the worst. We went to the library, we looked at everything.
Scott and I were sitting around We were just talking about stickers when we were kids, like on our, you know, banana seat bicycles and skateboards. We were just talking how cool the SCP sticker was. And he was like, we should do something with those initials. And I just blurted out, Stereo Temple Pirates. And we called Robert all excited. And Robert goes, I don't think I'm so into pirates. And he goes, what do you think of pilots? We're like, yeah, that's cool. And we called Steve, our manager. He's like, well, what do you think of Stone? And it just came out, Stone Temple Pilots. We kind of went with it.
I can remember being a little kid and you opened up the album and you looked at every song and you listened to every song and the whole album had a vibe, and that's what we were trying to create with Core, is make an album that just flowed from top to bottom with a vibe.
Core began creeping up the charts with its first single, Sex Type Thing, which secured heavy radio play and accusations of glorifying date rape.
It was just something really simple. Weiland put himself in the perspective of the idiot type person, for lack of a better term, who thinks like that and looks at women in that aspect. And you know the lyrics.
Dress up a little bit, you know, for all you macho type guys that might have misunderstood this song.
It might anger people at first who don't really understand what the song's about or what you know, where we come from on certain issues like that. But I think that in general the idea has come about.
And I feel the time's a ways ago.
Did you really write Plush in a Hot Tub with Eric? The lyrics.
Yeah, we did.
So we're just sitting in the hot tub throwing ideas back and forth. It was just kind of intimate between friends.
Is there anything wrong with two men being naked in a jacuzzi together?
Not those two men.
Writing songs about dogs and love.
Determined to prove themselves even further, the band hit the road, leaping from 500-seat clubs to 5,000-capacity venues as Megadeth's opener. Along the way, Plush was everywhere. Even an impromptu acoustic set inundated the airwaves.
Oh, when the dogs you find her, got time to wait for tomorrow.
The label wanted to put the acoustic version on some form of EP, which we weren't real keen on because that's one song off of an album. There's 11 other songs. We don't want this record to be thought of as the Plush album.
I don't really owe anybody anything. I think I owe myself something musically. And that's just to be honest about my own emotions, and because songs are derivative of human emotion, I mean, just hope in a perfect world that's what eventually will define you.
Half the man I used to be.
The summer of 93, Stone Temple Pilots were making the rock and roll rounds and gearing up to tour. They made the head-turning decision not to go on the road with Aerosmith, but to take part in an alternative package deal dubbed the Barbecue Mitzvah Tour.
This is really only our fourth tour, the only time we really had a chance to actually show people what we're about, and we just thought it was a better idea to hit more intimate places.
Normally at a concert you walk away spending probably $50 a person or something. More money than people can really afford, so we wanted to just, you know, keep it low.
For seeing three bands, it's a good show for $15.
STP's concern with affordable concert going and alternative ticket methods continues through today, as well as their concern of treating fans to the type of rock spectacles they were weaned on.
We just kind of wanted to just give something people could leave and really talk about, you know? Like the Kiss thing, you just gotta find ways to keep yourself entertained. Whether it's running out with a jock strap on or whatever, you know what I mean? Just to keep yourself entertained.
But the fun of touring began to wane. an incident involving an alleged shoe-throwing fan, and Weiland and Roberts' angry physical response earned the boys a lawsuit. Meanwhile, their disillusionment with the music industry grew as touring took its toll on them personally.
We should have quit touring after that point. Basically, it felt like all we were doing is making other people money, and with the that we had to deal with in some of the media in the last, you know, year really began making supporting that album a job and not fun anymore.
Ironically, in the midst of an antagonistic relationship with the press, STP were on top. By early 1994, the group had collected numerous awards, including a Grammy, two American Music Awards, one Billboard Award, and the Video Music Award for Best New Artist.
And the winner is Stone Temple Pilots.
Mostly say thank you to the people that have paid more attention to the music than they have to the media, because that's ultimately what matters the most. So to those people, thanks for the space, man.
STP did impress fans and critics alike with their unplugged interpretations. One of the show's highlights was Big Empty, a song that later catapulted the Crow soundtrack to the top of the charts.
Driving faster in my car, falling farther from just what we are.
Since we've been rehearsing for the show, it kind of brings you back to that initial feeling that you had that, you know, it really originally like inspired you to feel and to write.
Time to take her home, her dizzy head is contemplated.
Still feeling the emotional repercussions of the past year, the band took a well-needed break from each other before finally deciding to reconvene the songwriting process.
Artistically, we needed to do it. The new album was probably the only thing that saved us from breaking up, which is unfortunate that things got to that point, but I think certain things were created out of that tension that probably wouldn't have happened if we all would have been getting along, you know, all peachy and everything.
The second album.
Our next guests currently have the number one album in the country. Congratulations. Yeah. Very, very impressive. Well, ladies and gentlemen, do us a big favor. Say hello to Stone Temple Pilots. Kids!
I thought it was a valid growth from Core, and there was definitely different emotions thrown in that we were all feeling.
Lyrically speaking, the words are from a much more personal perspective. It's because of experiences. It means a lot more to me because of that.
Flies in the Vaseline we are. Sometimes it blows my mind. Keep getting stuck here all the time. Have you lost your sense?
Definitely on an artistic level, it's more experimental because I feel that rather than feeling this pressure to make something as acceptable as Core was, I think we actually felt more freedom to explore different sounds.
Interstate Love Song, the second single from Purple, was huge, spending a record-breaking 15 weeks at the top of the album rock charts. Stone Temple Pilots were now a headlining act. Except when they took the opportunity to open for the Rolling Stones.
It was like, oh, we're headlining our big tour. And then we went over to do those two shows and we realized how small our tour really was compared to that one.
In May of 1995, at the height of the band's success, Weiland became part of a rock and roll cliché.
Less than 24 hours after his arrest for possession of cocaine and heroin in Pasadena, California, Stone Temple Pilots singer Scott Weiland phoned up LA radio station KROQ and introduced his friend Courtney Love, who read a note in which Weiland called himself a man who has failed and apologized to his wife, his family, his friends, his bandmates, and his fans for having what he called the disease of drug addiction.
What prompted you to call into KROQ with an apology? Did you really Feel like you had to talk about it?
If I didn't say something first, I felt that a lot of people would be saying things for me or about me. I dreamed to make music for a living. It's my lifelong dream, and I've done it. But the things that came along with it, I didn't know. I wasn't prepared for a lot of those things. I have to remind myself to remain humble in the face of music all the time, or else that gift could be taken away, you know?
Is that jamming on the guitars?
Dean and I. That guitar was probably on about 11.
By the end of 1995, Stone Temple Pilots managed to have another hit song with their take of Led Zeppelin's Dancing Days from the Encomium tribute album. And Scott Weiland experimented with a side band, the Magnificent Bastards, who were featured on the soundtrack of Tank Girl. But as far as STP was concerned, the primary issue was putting aside their personal differences and Weiland's ongoing legal battle and getting back together as a music-making unit.
I think the main part that's satisfying about the writing is when a song, either by us three, is presented to Scott, his way of putting what he has to the song is really fulfilling.
I think that the stress of it's changed. The first album, it was kind of overwhelming. All of a sudden we're on a big label, and I think it forces you to second guess certain things more than we would now. You know, we kind of just follow our instincts a little bit more than we have in the past.
After several failed attempts in 95 to begin recording new material, the band finally did follow their instincts and headed to the Santa Ynez Mountains late in the year. They sequestered themselves on a 100-acre ranch that doubled as their home and recording studio. There they wrote, reconnected, and relearned how to be Stone Temple Pilots.
We hadn't played together in a year. I mean, the band had almost broken up. It was like starting over.
It worked out great, you know, and then when we all got together, it was a pretty good environment because we got to be like, you know, kids again, playing around all the time and making music, which is what we love. And it was really neat because we got to utilize the whole house. You know, everywhere the cables would reach, we utilized from the bathroom to cedar closets to the front lawn to the living room.
When you said the front lawn, did they actually put you on the front lawn?
Yeah, we tried about four different rooms, and it wasn't sounding right. You know, it was sounding too big, and we wanted it to be a little drier and tighter. I wanted to be by the pool because it was a nice sunset, and the cables wouldn't reach out there, so we ended up, doing it the front lawn.
Many of their unique recording techniques can be traced back to producer Brendan O'Brien, the man behind their last two records, as well as works for Neil Young, Matthew Sweet, and Pearl Jam.
He's just truly amazing. He has impeccable ears. He's a great guitar player. And when we're doing something, it's like we don't even have to talk. What I'm trying to convey onto tape, he already hears it without me even explaining it, and it just happens, you know?
What is the vibe of this record?
It's more raw, I would say, than the other two, only because it's less produced than, say, the last one. We really got into experimenting with a lot of things, and on this one it's a little more straight ahead.
If somebody had played that for me and said, "Who's this band?" I wouldn't have said Stone Temple Pilots.
That's good.
Interesting instruments.
Yeah. It just goes back to, I think we all have an appreciation for so many kinds of music.
Mm-hmm. Any song on that record that you have as a favorite?
Yeah, I think Adhesive is probably my favorite. Uh-huh. Especially what he did lyrically on that one. It's really amazing. Adhesive.
What about you, Scott?
Seven Cage Tigers.
I'll put a vote for that one, too. That actually sounds like something he would have done maybe 10 years ago when we first started.
STP's visual image is often as strong as their music. But when the time came to shoot the first video for Tiny Music, they decided to tone things down and get back to the basics.
So we've done some sagas.
Yeah, a couple epics.
Yeah.
Why go lo-fi?
We've never done something where it's like, okay, music and we're just playing. So we wanted to make it as basic as we could get.
Temple Pilots stripped down both sound and visuals for Tiny Music, and while music is foremost in the group's mind, its members must still contend with past ghosts, present critics, and future decisions. Despite what's behind them and the unknown ahead, Stone Temple Pilots seem ready to get on with their musical lives.
It's taken such a long time, not the recording process, but the waiting around and trying to get started on it. I think it's just a nice fact knowing that we have another great album.
A lot of people just view the musicians as like, okay, he's the bass player, he's the drummer. Well, it's not that way. We all contribute. It's really just a beautiful thing when the four of us do this.
Thunder in the distance.